Grateful to the Lord for being able to come. I had several things. Somebody really wanted me to be in a breakfast meeting this morning and was not releasing me. But between the two meetings and what he wanted me to do in the breakfast meeting and here, I felt my heart was here. So for a time, because he was trying to convince me, I didn't come to immediately because I had to struggle with the person. But I'm glad I came, because I think this is one of the most important meetings a church can hold.
Amen.
Very quick reasons. Because the reason this church exists is mission. So when you have a meeting to arrange a wedding, it's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
But it's not as critical as a mission meeting. When you have a meeting, about the program of the church, which is very important. You are reading about the speaking, what you are going to talk about in the next quarter. It's a very important meeting. But the truth of the matter is, I think you still not as important as a church meeting. The most important thing you can hold is to discuss the mission of the church. But the mission, those are important issues, but the mission of the church is the Great Commission. And I think it's important that will be dealt with. So that's what made me come here. Makere was supposed to be in a career day at Kikuyu campus, where my friend and I used to be regular. And when he told me, I said, I can go in the afternoon. Then the student changed their mind and said, they are only going to hold it the earlier part. So I'm already in a struggle as to whether I'll be able to make it. So it was quite a thing of succeeding. Can you read it from the back? It normally works, so no wonder why this is the equipment other than mine. I've just been doing presentations this week and it was working.
It's not our equipment, it's our knowledge, it's our expertise.
Can we get remote?
Yeah, because certainly it seems to have. You can see the picture of my family is wider than this, so it means there is a communication between the two machines. So, these things did not exist in the days of Jesus, and still ran meetings. So we can still go on. But I just wanted to mention that to me this is a very, very important meeting. Not to make the other meetings not important, but I think it's very, very important. And I have known that all my life, that when a church is not involved in mission, it's not a dead church. It's only a dying church. In other words, it will not be dead. It will look vibrant. But if it's not doing mission, it's not dead, but it is dying. That's what has happened to the churches in Europe, where they become so involved in themselves and in what they are doing, within no time you think you are preserving yourself, you will soon be dead. So a church that thinks about mission is a church that's going places, and the church that is likely to get the blessings of the Lord as it goes on. I want to begin by reading Acts chapter 1 verse 8. That will be the theme verse for us throughout today. Acts 1:8 says in the NIV, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." That's our theme throughout today. I come from NPC Valley Road, Church Valley Road. We are now called Sitam. And the pastor can easily disown me because I hardly go to church. Since you see me in Lavington, next time I'm in another church, and next time. So the last So the last of that years, somehow my diary has opened up and I go from universities to schools to churches. So I move quite a bit. But my home base, where my children went to Sunday school, is Barrow Road. And I've been involved, I've been a deacon, I've been an elder, I've been a lay minister, I've been involved in all levels of leadership. But with the pastor and the bishop knowing that I still have ministry outside the church. Some 5 years ago, I was the secretary to the Council of Elders, and we were debating the issue of the church involvement in mission. Because the parentage of CITAM is the same parentage with the PAG. The PAG was started by Canadian missionaries, and PAG is Pentecostal Assemblies of God. They are a worldwide church. But in Kenya, it's called, we just referred to it as PAG. The Canadians started the church in Kenya. And then in addition to that, they started a church with a different registration called Nairobi Pentecostal Church. And Nairobi Pentecostal Church is not part of PAG. It was started as a town church to try to reach the elite of the city as a way of doing mission among a certain class of people. That's why the rest of the PAG churches were run in Swahili and the vernacular, but the Barrow Road was supposed to run in English as a way of reaching a certain type of people within the nation. Of course, like Lavington, one could very easily agree with you, it was not technology. It's finally bigger. So one of the things then was, how do you reach a certain class of people? And I'm saying, because of that, one could very easily say that they could be accused of being snobs, in the sense that how come you speak only English, and there are people who don't understand English. But that's something, at least in the church leadership, we have debated with, that there is an unreached people group called the educated, and I'm sure Lavington knows about it, that there are people who feel like they can't go to a church because it's not appealing to a certain type of messages. And so there is a people that need to be reached. But generally speaking, we took our responsibility for mission as tithing our money to PAG that were having missionaries among the rich people. And so we gave money every year. And every year those missionaries will come among their leaders, but all the rich people group will come to Barrow Road on a certain Sunday and give reports. But we had very little involvement as a church. And so once we were in the Council of Elders, we started saying, would God take us as a church, ever having carried out their mission? That's why we decided we'll still continue giving money to PAG and others, but we ourselves as a church must be involved in mission. So the bishop and the Council of Elders asked me to start for about a year. I had a steering committee, thinking and praying and studying the scriptures as how a church can be involved in mission. And we finally developed a mission policy for the church, and said certain of the things I'll be sharing are the things we learned and the things we started. One of the things we agreed right from the word go is that mission will be several things in in our definition, there is not going to be mission without what we are calling outreach. In other words, outreach is evangelism around yourself. You are reaching out, you are not really going far. And we say the church must be involved in what we define as outreach. Of course, that's a limited meaning, because we give it our own meaning. That the people, where the church is located, if people around there don't get saved, God will hold that responsible. Because that is your Jerusalem. And when the passage you have read has said that you cannot skip to Samaria without looking at Jerusalem. And so it means geographically, wherever our branches are placed, the responsibility of that branch is to ensure the people of that village, the people of that city, get to know the Lord. And you must have clear designs as to how you are reaching that particular area. Strategic means of actually saying this town has rejected Christ. You cannot use the word rejected if you have not told them. And you know, a lot of people tell non-Christians they are rejected, but they have never told them. You know, for example, you can start an open air there, but nobody is listening. Then you say people have rejected. They never heard. They may even have thought you are mad. Now, it's important to ask yourself, exactly how do you communicate the gospel so that you can say people have rejected. I tell people in the university, for example, a lot of students in the university don't go to church. Why? They view clever, intellectual, and the understanding Jesus is only relevant to the uneducated, to the mother. So when he's very proud that his mother is saved. He's very proud that the mother goes to church. But for me who is educated, Jesus has nothing to do with me. So when he comes to the university and sees a Christian union, he wonders what's wrong with them. You are young and you're doing something like that, they don't go. Because to them, Jesus is a long dress. And since the young lady doesn't want to wear a long dress, he doesn't want Jesus. Because in their definition, the Jesus they are rejecting is the Jesus of the long dress. Now, who will tell them, that's not our Jesus? That's the mother's Jesus. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? And you can never tell somebody they have rejected Christ until they know the real Christ, and then they say no to that Christ. So there must be communication. So outreach is where you are tackling your Jerusalem and you are dealing with it in a way that you can accurately say these people have rejected Christ. So there must be clear designs. I'll be mentioning later that outreach is outreach. The commission is not come ye, it's go ye. You see the joke? A lot of churches believe the commission is come ye. So they are always inviting Lovington people to come to church. That's not the word of God. The word of God is not that Christians come here. It's that Christians go. And until the church structure changes from telling people to come to telling people to go, they will never do what you see. And the average church in Kenya does not have outreach. It has come. Come. Go and tell your friends to come. It does not train its people as to why they can or how they can go. So that's the first thing that they said was important in the Jerusalem. And then he said, you need to find a way of reaching Samaria. And in a minute I'll be coming to it. These are regions that are not immediate. Jerusalem are people that are culturally like you. It's not difficult. Like if you live in Lavington, although there may be Mbuakari, once you knock at the door, they say, it's your neighbor. Do you think they refuse to open? No, so it's easy to deal with your neighbors. So when you're talking about Jerusalem, there are people you can handle. But when you reach Samaria, they are not far from you, but they are not like you. They don't behave like you. Maybe Samaria for Lavington is Gatina or whatever you call the other church where you're placed, the other church. There are people who are your neighbors, but their culture is not like yours. And when you go there, you don't know exactly how to behave. And you have to find a method where you are going makes you go to outside your comfort zone. Because Jerusalem is your comfort zone. You are only not witness because you are lazy. But there's nothing very difficult about Jerusalem. But when you start going to Samaria, you are going to a place where they may not be far from you, but they are not like you. The Jews and the Samaritans were not exactly the same. In the first meeting, I came from another meeting before coming here, and you are actually reading John chapter 4, the story of the Samaritan lady. And you can see clearly, he says, why are you talking to me and I'm not a Jew? I'm a Samaritan. In other words, they were neighbors, but they didn't talk to each other. And that's what we are talking about. Who are those? And for you as Lavington United, you must define for yourself what is Samaria to you. Because it's important, you cannot go to Jerusalem and do nothing about Samaria until you're a mission church. So there must be things you are doing in Jerusalem, some you are doing in Samaria. And since I'm only dealing with the introduction, you finally must also be involved in Judea and the far parts of the earth, like the word they say. So in our mission statement, therefore, we were able to develop all that, and we started picking out. Because when you talk about going to the uttermost parts of the earth, it's going where Christ has never been heard. When you go there and you tell people about Jesus, they ask you, is he a chief? Now, for you to expect, do you know Jesus? Oh, is he a chief of the area? Because obviously they know the only name you cannot be able to know is the name of the chief. But they have never heard of Jesus. By the way, there are such people in this country where you ask them, do you know Jesus? They ask you, is he a chief? In other words, for you to expect me to know him, he must be pretty well known. Yes, they have never heard of him. What is embarrassing is to imagine a city here, After 150 years of Christianity in this small country. No, Kenya is not big. It's not as big as Tanzania, for example. It's only maybe almost a half of Ethiopia. So for Kenya, after 150 years, to still have people who have never heard the gospel is a mark of embarrassment for us as Christians. And because of my involvement in church, I actually started in mission. Well, of course, the first thing is to create the policy. Afterwards, we started sending missionaries. And I've been among the Saburus, we picked Saburus, then we booked Retires, then we booked Boranas, were our first three tribes. Because the idea is you have to be strategic, you have to think of what you are going. Even if you are going everywhere, you have to have a system of going. And so those were the first three, and I've actually been among the three, at least I've been to Redire several times, been to Borana several times. And you go there, and actually you are reaching people who are in Kenya, like among the Redires, you are in Kenya, but they are living like in the last century, both in terms of development and in terms of... So I remember meeting an AIM missionary in a place among the Radires where the AIC started a mission earlier, because they were earlier, we went to learn from them before going, we went to another path where they had not been, but we first of all went to learn from them. And I asked, what could have happened that Christianity could have been in Kenya this number of years and you are meeting people like this? And he explained that in the colonial era, the Kenyan colonial government had decided beyond Isiolo, no missionary was allowed beyond Isiolo. That the Muslims were allocated beyond Isiolo. Anybody else was Kabiri out there, you could actually bother. But for Muslims, you're supposed to leave them aside. And unfortunately, I have never read that one in any history book. So I had never heard of it. But it now made sense. Because you're not telling us that the reason they didn't go to the north was because it was a difficult area. The Maasai's were wild, you remember? Now, so it was a very difficult place. The malaria was terrible everywhere. Like in Kisumu, there was a lot of malaria, but they still went there. And it started making sense why the Christianity does not go beyond Isiolo, beyond the Mwingi. The whole of northern Kenya, no Christianity actually went. But then the Mzungu was cheated. After finishing the sentence, he said, after independence, the rule did not apply. So why haven't you gone? Because you see, he is there, he has been in that place for 30 years. And there isn't many churches that have actually, not many churches have gone to the place. We haven't, now we have no reason not to go. But you haven't gone. Do you know there are still about 22 tribes in this country that still do not have any witness? Remember, you do not save, it's Christ who saves, isn't it? Your job is not to save. Your job is to be a witness. But those people have not rejected Christ. They have never heard of him. And what? The reason why you saw I cancelled other things that I was doing to come here is to be able to challenge Lavington United and say, the number of tribes that are currently remaining are such that without going to the rest of Kenya, Nairobi City alone, if Valley Road takes three tribes, Lavington takes, you're not as big as Valley Road, take only two tribes. And you know those tribes? You hear 40,000 people are one tribe. Even when you hear they are called tribes, do not think they are like lawyers. They're just a few people. But they speak their own tribe, they are very proud, they fight each other tribe, because they are proud to be their tribe. And even if you translate the Bible in this language, these other ones will not know. So it's a full people group. Question mark. How much do they take? It's not even a big budget. If you are talking about those kind of people, to make an impact among them, it's just to send a missionary couple, support them, and then have some means of creating a presence among them. And within 10 years, there will be things that are happening there that will create a witness among them. You get my point? It isn't a very difficult thing to actually do. But I can't explain what has happened, because you hear we are in Barrow doing nothing. When he started doing, we learned, like for example, one of the things that really surprised us, because most of us are intellectuals, and when you are at the church and you are reaching intellectuals, you tend to be intellectuals. You tend to approach something in a very academic way. Ever heard of the analysis, the reasons to paralysis? Yeah, that you are so analytical that basically you can hardly move. When you finally took the three tribes, like I can give you the example of among the leaders. We recruited missionaries, we created things, we created a budget, we went to a place called Kagi. Kagi is middle of among the leaders, and there was no missionary presence. And we went there. Now the first thing is to look how to go. You go to the chief, our missionaries, went to it's a couple. They went to the chief, sought permission, whatever. Do you know, the day they started their service in a borrowed place and started witnessing, the leaders started coming. You know, the impression we had given them is that they are going to go. The first year is just getting to be known, you know. So we didn't expect a church, we expected a presence. Because that's what you have read in the books, that the first year you are getting to know the people. Do you know when they started a prayer meeting, people came, not that they got saved, but they were excited about coming. Then there was no rain. They prayed, they said, what do you like to pray? Rain. Rain fell. They said, that God who brings rain, we are going there. By the time, within a few months, I was the chairman of the committee, we went now to see what happened. We went with the bishop to the place. We went by air to masturbate, and then took the church vehicle now into the bush in Redire. Do you know the service he went to was a service overflowing in like a small place where they had set apart? And up to now, the church, within 6 months, we are talking about how to split the church. So that the clans of this side meet one place, the clans of the other side meet in another place, because it would work too many to be dealt with. Now, obviously, I asked the pastor, are you sure they are saved? He says, whether they are saved, only God can answer. But they are so excited about coming to church, that every Sunday, we had now to set short-time missionaries to try to deal with them. In other words, they changed what is written in the books. Because they just came. They want to hear about this God. And although they don't know what they are committing themselves to, they just think that God is worth praying to. And so now, what has happened, instead of evangelizing them, you are now discipling them from scratch. Obviously, after some understand, they run away. What they know, is that what I was committing myself to? I have to stop my normal, I have to stop that and stop that. And of course, he has given me many stories about complications. About, for example, a wife, what a wife is to do, and what happens when a man dies and you want to inherit the wife. You see, they have come quickly without any teaching. So you just follow the traditions. So there are struggles with it. I want you to get the real picture. That doesn't mean they all got saved at a go. But the point is, the process we had assumed did not happen. The Lord was with the work and changed the picture. So now they are not two. Within 3 years from the time we started, they have now called us to another village somewhere. You know, you hear this village has a church. We are now in three points within the region. And it's not a very big tribe. So it just sounds like all I was waiting for was a church willing to go. And a church that concentrates. Because you can get excited and now go among all the other people without finally leaving a witness in that particular group. Because my understanding of mission work is you enter, from the day you enter, you try to dislocate yourself. In other words, you are not going there for good. You are going there so that within 10, 15 years, you can go to another tribe. Why? You, by that time, you have 10 years of people in the place. By the 10th year, you'll be able to pick a young man from the place, get him to a Bible school. By the 15th year, they can have a pastor of their own. Are you getting the picture? So that, and you know our policy, and then they change it. The policy we wrote, that is not a system church. We want them to have their own church. So it's not corona. We are not trying to colonize them. We are trying to create a witness of the Lord. And whatever name they want to register, they can register. They may have been missionary system, but when they have running their own thing, they can call it whatever they want to call it. So they can see clearly, we were not after increasing our kingdom, we were after increasing God's kingdom. And you know that gives them a lot of freedom when they realize we are not here to stay. We are here to release issues. So right from the beginning, as they are getting saved, you start giving the elders some responsibilities. As they are growing, as you are teaching them more, of course you have to be there because you must disciple them. That's a requirement of God's word. Among the Boranas, we went, since there was already churches within Masabe town, we went into the right inside, now out of Masabe town. And we sent a couple, again it's a couple, and in this instance we were blessed to find a Kisi man when he was in Bible school, he was very in love with a Borana girl. Now, so obviously it was very easy now to pick the two and send them to them because, of course, even in trying to run Borana, he has a local tutor. So it was much easier for him working there. But I want to tell you the same thing happened. It's happened among the Latinos, the same thing happened. They borrowed a place to start a structure and now start moving around witnessing in the village and started the church. I still went within the first 1 year. I found when I spoke to that church, people were seated outside. Because they had built a small church, expecting now it will need time to grow. But they were actually overflowing. Within 2 years, we have been forced to move to another church. And there we have now, that's what we are going to call the main big mission station for the whole of northern Kenya, where we are building. So we have bought about, I think, almost 20 acres of land. And we are hoping that's where the Bible College will be and the schools and everything in the place. Now, not the way we started, but where you bought the land is a better place. And now a new church has started there. So just like Boranas having three points, now the Ladidas having 3 points, the Boranas. And you're just talking about the last 5 years. It's not a long story. And there are now people born again and walking with the Lord within that period of time. Completely not what the committee was, not what my committee, and I'm owning up. I was in the committee that saw like it will be a slow process in trying to get people to understand. And I look at that and say, how long did we take to actually start doing something about it? And I'm grateful to the Lord. Now, system has gone beyond that. Because within no time, as we are sitting there, we started getting people saying that we have to do other things in other tribes. But because the policy we wrote clearly says you must do something in one place until the presence is felt, what we have done is create mission trips. We have gone among the Turkanas, where we now help the missionaries of other churches that are there. We go and help them to do a certain like training, discipling, whatever, mission conferences in the place. But not necessarily locate ourselves long term in the place. Then in Sudan, southern Sudan, we have started work, and there are missionaries we have sent there, but again, partnering with other people in the place. Then two, three years ago, somebody came from the Far East and said, Africa is the one that is now expected to carry the mission touch for the rest of the world. Like I'll be showing you in a few minutes, assuming I'll get enough time, that the center has moved. In years gone by, the center of the church was the West. But the church in the West is on its way down. Every day down. Last night we were discussing with my daughter about the announcement by the Obama that he is going, that for him there's no debate about the gay. They must get all the rights. It's normal to be gay. It's not abnormal. Now, and they say, surely, my daughter said, is he committing political suicide? I told him, you don't know. The guy has read the picture. The church is dying. Many of the people in church already are gay. And in fact, not just local members, you know that in the Anglican church, a number of them are bishops. Are we together? So who is not going to vote for him? He will even get more votes, isn't he? Because now it will not matter whether you are Republican or whichever party, because both parties have been unsure about where to stand. Now that this one is sure, all people who regard homosexuality as normal will now give him the vote. And you might see him winning. Whereas the average Christian doesn't think so. But that just tells you the condition of the church. That's why he can dare that. A few years ago, he was not even there. He would be resigned first. But now he knows he can still win. That's where the church in the West is. And in many places in Europe, a lot of churches are changing, are becoming mosques, and they are becoming bars. You have heard of that? So that it is Africa where the church is growing by leaps and bounds. And so if Christianity is to survive, and it will, because it's God's work, isn't it? It will mean that we in Africa must all of a sudden not be missionary receiving, but be missionary sending. And that has to start yesterday. In other words, it's not something we are saying that our children will do. It is something we must do now. And so, although as chairman, I was pretty resistant, I'm looking at the budget, looking at the monies we have, we said, well, we are not even, we are still, because there are many things we need to do among the three tribes we picked, and we are not doing that well. Now, what about the money? I said, no. It says Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the end of the earth. It did not say, finish Jerusalem. Full stop. After that, have you read the passage? It doesn't say after that. It says and. Are you getting the point? So that you can't say that, but I'm in Jerusalem. Why are you asking me to go? And so the other, last year, we finally sent, last year but one, we finally sent a mission, a park fighting mission in Indonesia. And we partnered with people, a church that is in Singapore that's already doing work there. And they came back and said, those are people, the Catholic Church seems to have gone there. What do you call the small section of Timorese?
East Timor,
that's the word I was looking for. They have independence. That means, because Indonesia is Muslim, but East Timor has just gotten independence. They are open to the gospel, but many of them are not yet where they can stand on their own. And so we've just sent our first missionary couple. Last year, it's 1 year old. One year old among the Timorese. So that's our first international mission. But we are still partnering with the church in Singapore in order to do the work. And it's going on. I thought I should start with a testimony as a way of telling you, you may sit here saying Nairobi is doing nothing, but it's Lavington not doing, not other churches. Are you getting my challenge? That it's not something that's not being done. And of course, you have had a pastor talking about parklands and the many missionaries they actually have. So it's important that we actually deal with that right from the beginning. Given that testimony, let's start by saying the reason why we must go is because Jesus commanded us to go. Jesus gave the Great Commission 2,000 years ago. However, 2/3 of the world are still not followers of Christ. And billions still have never heard of the Lord Jesus Christ. Rather than waiting for people who don't know Christ to come to us, we need to go to them. Why? Because Jesus commanded us to go. Yet very few Kenyan Christians are involved in obeying the mission. If you want to know that the church is not involved in mission, just look at the church budget today. We must transform ourselves and the church to start obeying the Great Commission. And I think it will be important that we actually deal with that in a way that will honor God. So that's the introduction I wanted to give. But my emphasis before tea is on outreach, not necessarily mission. Because I think that's the thing that we want to ensure we start with. I'm saying, what's the biblical basis for success, for holistic societal engagement? Because the idea is the church must engage the society. What's the biblical basis? The first thing is, we must define what the church is. What is a church? My definition of the church is a members club. To me, that's a very important thing for people to understand. Not everybody is a church. The number of people who come to Lavington United are not all members of the church. To be a member of Christ's church, you must be born again. If you are in this church and you are not born again, you may be here, but you are an escort. You know the presidential escort goes to many places, isn't it? But they escort. That's why Obamas went to see prostitutes when the Obamas left. You have heard, you read the story in the press. They are not part of the, they are not the presidency. They are on the escort. And it's important to be aware. And we don't want to discourage those people coming. Because faith comes by hearing. But you must understand that the church must emphasize. If it's going to become a missionary church, it must be clearly aware that the church is a members club. And in a members club, you don't just happen to enter. There's a process, isn't it? And so it's important that any church that wants to be a missionary church must guard its membership. People should not just happen to join. Because you think they are joining by mistake, within no time, they are gone. Isn't that what happened to Christian universities? I was talking to a professor who told me about Harvard, all the big universities of America were Christian universities. Then within no time they say any clever person is welcome. And obviously you become a, you enter as an un-Christian, you're a professor, within no time you say it's embarrassing for us to be praying on campus. Within no time, you have no idea that Harvard is a church university. And this church can suffer exactly the same consequence. Once you open up that anybody, as long as it's a big name, can become a member of the church. It's not Christianity. Because the Bible defines who a Christian is and the process. And even if you change it, you can have your own thing, but don't call it a church. Please give it another name. If you change the membership requirements of the church. You can't have somebody keeping a second and a third wife, and is in the leadership of the church, and you're calling yourself a church. And they say, we are being accommodative. In a members club, you don't enter. You have to clear things at the reception. Are we together? And it's important that a church that you'll be missionary. Why am I emphasizing this? Because for you to go out, people must see you as having something to give. The minute they realize that the guy who was drinking with them yesterday is your leader, you think they'll take you seriously? That you said, which you are witnessing to me. Which church you come from? Oh, that one. But your drinking mate has never told, my drinking mate is your chairman. He has never, not this one. But he has never told me about it. You will be trying to waste your money and your effort if your leadership has opened up. And remember, anybody who becomes a member of the church is potentially the future chairman. Am I right? Because for this friend of mine to become chairman, all he needed is to join the church, isn't it? So even the part, anybody who becomes a member is potential. And people know how to campaign. So if he really wants to become chairman, he doesn't have to be saved. He will do the right things. And so I thought we need to define this, because the reason why the church is failing to accurately carry out its role is because in committees are people who have a different viewpoint of what the church is. They came to their own social thing. You are not disturbing them by telling them to go. But you are the one who allowed them in the first place, isn't it? So it's important to understand the church is a members club. The word of God is absolutely clear. Not everyone can be a part of the church. Everybody is welcome, but there is a gate. Only the thief can go over, isn't it? And he says, Jesus is saying he's a shepherd, isn't it? And he has a door that to allow which sheep comes in. And he is very interested in the other sheep. That's why the second part of the statement, let me now finish it. The church is a members club, but it exists for non-members. Are you getting it? That the purpose of the church is for the welfare of the non-members. So you're a members club, but if somebody was to read your minutes, all the time your discussion is how you can get more members. Are we together? There is absolutely nothing in your organization that is for attending to your members. So when you find a church that is interested, we are not entertaining, we have no party, we are not helping people in their weddings, if that's what is your main concentration, that is a members club that exists for its own members. And I told you earlier, look at the budget. The budget will tell you if you are a club or a church. Because in a members club, and I'm a member of a club, during the AGM we audited to be sure that all the money was used on us. If we saw money used on non-members, that committee will be fired. Can't last. Because a members club exists for members. But a church is different. It's a members club that exists for non-members. You know, and I thought I would say it later, but let me say it right in the introduction. I have really been bothered when I hear you, somebody comes to church and says, my relative have died, can you bury him? And the first question the pastor asks is, which church do you attend? And on the basis of that answer, he either the dead man will be buried or not buried. And I say, surely, you look at that pastor, you just sympathize with him. You now don't know whether to blame the Bible school or himself. Because you need to understand that the reason you become a pastor is to reach out, isn't it? Now, let me ask you, do you know if you go to a funeral, that's the most appropriate place to preach the gospel? Somebody invites you to come and bury his dead body. And remember, you are not preaching to the dead body. It's the relatives. And you say, sorry, you are not coming to my church. Now, are you hearing it? That God has given you opportunity to preach, even to people you have nothing to do with. And you say, sorry, you are done nothing. It just feels you, that pastor has a problem. Are we together? That, and you know that's a normal. By the way, when I say that, it's not you. The average church in Nairobi will not bury you unless you are from their church. But it's not scriptural. Because in the scripture, if I have two people to bury, a member whose relatives are saved and an unmember who have nobody who goes to church, I will not bury, I will send an elder or somebody else to bury the member. The place I'm needed is here, because you know, if the dead man is a non-Christian, guess who is likely to come for the meetings? Non-Christians. So how would you ever go to a Christian barrio when you have opportunity to go to a non-Christian barrio? You know, I'm saying this like that is a joke. And when AIDS started, one of the early people to die was one of my workmates. And when I heard, I knew he was sick, because he was one friend. So when he got AIDS, he was sick, and we talked for quite a bit of time. Then one day, you know, they get well, they go away, then he comes back. Then one day he went, and I was told he had died. Since I asked for where the house is, I went to the place. I went, it's a Luo couple, and I went, and the house was dead quiet. Nobody talking, it was, you know, only crying. Nothing happening. And I sat there, and I don't know how to talk, and I just went to the wife of my friend and said, is it okay if I prayed? The lady took me aside and said, are you serious? You mean you can organize for us? I said, what? He said, now me, I thought I was asking for time to pray that day. She said, can you take over? And you know, with a Luo barrio, take over means another 2-3 weeks. I'm getting the point. And my diary normally has, especially before I retired, I have shell work, I have many things on my diary. But you see, I asked her, what happened? We used to go to, she go to the church they attend. When she, after the husband died, she went there, and they checked the name of the husband in the register. He was not there. They said, no, we don't know him. We don't know you. But we used to come to this church. You have no record of yours. The lady, they were seated like that, totally lost. They said at home, the mother-in-law can organize. But here in town, they have no church. So Brother Nanga, don't just take over today until the barrio. So it was now my job every evening to be there. And because it was a non-Christian, guess who was coming? It means I had a crusade for the next 2 weeks. Now you need to understand clearly that this concept is critical to becoming a mission church. Where you understand the church is a members club that exists for non-members. So when you start seeing a big proportion of your budget going to assist members, something is going wrong. Members are supposed to have their own money to look after themselves. No wonder they tithe. And when they tithe, they leave 90%, isn't it? So they are supposed to be looking after them. The rest of the money, the majority of the money, must be shown to be helping non-church members. And when you change that concept, do you know what will happen? Your church will still continue having needs. You will still want to build. But even now, when you are not giving to mission, you still don't have enough money. Even then, you still not have enough. But because you have changed your concept, it changes. That's what we did in Ivory Road. A decision was made at an AGM that 10% of the money, whatever income, so that we don't have a limit. If God blesses us, if we are raising 1 million shillings per year, 100,000 must go to mission. If the Lord blesses us and we get 20 million, At that time, the deacon would start saying, "Hi, that means 2 million. Hi, can the mission board handle that?" Now, because you see, 100,000 we could handle, but 2 million. And we have not even put up a tower, we have not put up the church in a tent in such a place. Is there in a way of trying to change this concept? Was it written in blood? Can we change it? The temptation is, there are so many needs of the church, you change it. But I thank God that the AGMs have not changed it. The elders' council is able to bear their weight on the deacon board to tell them that you have many problems. But if the day you take away the tithe because you have many problems, you are teaching the church members to do the same. When they have school fees, like this man, when you are going back to school, can you tithe? You have the same argument. The reason I'm not bringing tithe now is because I'm paying. Because that's the same church, the same thing the church is saying. The reason we cannot give to mission is because you are now doing construction. You are now teaching your members to do exactly the same. So the church must maintain that idea of traveling with the little money they have rather than touch the mission money. Are we together? And when you do that, all of a sudden you have a lot of money that is available. Now it will be now looking for people who are going to go for mission. Because now the money is available. And I told you, one of the things that happens when you get a missionary heart is that everybody becomes, when people are just coming to church and sitting and idle, even their pockets close up. Whenever you start getting people involved and you become deeper in the Lord, the other thing, the pocket also opens. So that the church raises more money when it has an active congregation than when it has a sitting congregation. So that the money, although you are giving 10% to mission, it will be originally maybe 10% of 1 million, it will soon be 10% of 2 million. So instead of being left with 900,000, you'll be left with 18 million shillings. Are we together? So you have actually got more money. Because that's what the church is expected to do. The church is supposed to raise money. Like the picture of the church we have in Paul. Paul is telling them when you meet on the first day of the week, because even by then they had stopped meeting on Saturday, on the Sabbath. They were meeting on the first day of the week. When you meet on the first day of the week, he says, raise money. What was the money for? To help others. Do you remember the story in the book of Acts? It was not for themselves. It's for others. And it's important that we raise that. So I wanted to start at that. Is Arlington United Church a club or a church? Remember, the defining fact is whether it exists for members or for non-members. I remember saying, what did you do with our money? Because the members were giving for their own good. They were not giving to God. They were giving for their own good so that they can have better chairs, so they can have better parties, it was their own money. It was not God's money. If it is God's money, it is because it's meant. Because Jesus says, I have sheep outside the fold, isn't it? And it means you must find a way of raising the money. And the members who are giving are already aware. This money is not for helping us. This money is for reaching out to people who are outside the church. The Great Commission, like I said earlier, the Great Commission is not for non-Christians to come. It's for Christians to go. So we are saying the church must find out, is it actually going at all? If it's going, like now the mission committee here can say, what are the strategies of going to your Jerusalem? What are your strategies of going to your Samaria? But in addition to that, we took a whole year writing the thing. The father said, surely, you write forever. What are you going to do? Because strategies are not enough. It's actions. Are we together? So there must be clear actions that you are taking. You go, even if you begin only with Saburus, because Saburus are Achas Post. We are missionaries at Achas Post, which is not very far. This place is on tarmac. Now, but whatever it is you are doing, action must happen. You know, mission is this. A mission church is this. The whole church going to the whole world with the whole gospel. I'm not original with this. This is Lusan Committee for Evangelization Conference 1989 in Manila, Philippines. That's what they defined what is going to happen to the church. A Christian church must be a church where the whole church is going to the whole world with the whole gospel. Let's now go step by step. The whole church is your mission. And I'll be coming back repeating myself. Is loving, united, understanding of mission, a committee. In other words, they are involved in mission because the committee is involved in mission. That's not the concept of church. Church is where every born again believer is doing something about the lost. And I would like to mention, I don't think I will have enough time to mention, a lot of people think that you can do that by giving your money. I have a website where some of the things I'm saying are already put there, so I'll refer to it because I'm seeing I'm running out of time. If you go to my website, that's John Ganga without apostrophes, johnganga.org. You'll see some materials in what I'm discussing today. And what I'm trying to say is, like one of the things I put in my website is, why don't professionals get involved in Christian work? And I say one of the major reasons is because somebody cheated them that money can do evangelism. So somebody feels like, me, I'm busy, so what do I do? I would not just tithe. I would tithe, you know, 20%. Some of these people are giving. They are serious Christians, and they are giving a lot of money to God's work. And for them, when you say, are you involved in mission? Yes, I give. But they don't ever tell anybody about the Lord Jesus Christ. Ask you a question. Where in the Bible did you ever hear that you can fulfill God's commission by giving money? It's not in the scriptures at all. It's not your money to go, it's you to go. So it's and I argued, I've actually now put it in a book, which is with a printer. I gave permission to the editor last week, so I'm hoping within the next 2 weeks the book will come. I'm calling the book The Christian Professional Leading in the Marketplace. And the whole thing is this idea of the whole church getting involved. In other words, pastors can never go to the marketplace. Only people in the marketplace are expected to witness in the marketplace. The work of the pastor is to wait for you here. Because he's supposed to equip you so that the next 6 days you do evangelism. Are we together? So that's what you're talking about, the whole church, involving the whole church. You cannot, the way to estimate whether Lovington United has become a mission church is to check each Sunday how many people told one person about the Lord Jesus Christ. And the bigger the percentage of the people involved in evangelism, the more. Remember, I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about you. Money will never save anybody. The Bible says, faith comes by money. Have you read that? No, it doesn't. The Bible says, faith comes by hearing. And money never talks. Are we together? So there must be a born again person. All of you here who are saved, is there anybody who got saved through money? Somebody came in 1964, came to my school. And Amuzee, who didn't know how to teach young people. So instead of teaching me, they started preaching to me and doing another call. So I made the mistake of getting saved. Because later I learned that children who are not old are not supposed to be told to get saved. But that Amuzee did not know that. That's how I came to know the Lord in 1964, before I left primary school. Because the Amuzee just came and preached to us like we are grown-ups. And told us we are going to hell if you don't receive the Lord. For a number of years I resisted. But finally I asked myself, I was doing very well in school. I said, is it true there is hell? Is this Mosey right? And you know those days, the Sunday school in the primary school was compulsory. Those of you who went to school in the colonial days, am I right? It was, in other words, every missionary school had a Sunday school where you went, not because you are a Christian, but because you are from the school. Then on Monday morning, all those who did not attend that school had to give their back for straightening. Now, that's the normal missionary. That's the normal missionary. Anybody here who is over 50 will understand what I'm talking about. So, even after you got independence, that went on for quite a while. Where every missionary school, you had to be straightened. So, you are not going to school because you like Christianity. You're just giving your back side. Now, so that's the only reason you are going there. So that's how I got saved, because I went compulsory, then I kept asking, and then I asked myself, is there really hell? And I started saying, to be honest, I think the Bible is true. If the Bible is true, hell is real. Then I said, I'm regarded as a clever boy in class. How can a clever person go to hell knowingly? It's okay to go without knowing, but you are. How can a clever person go to hell knowingly? That's what the next time the Muslim did in Sota call, I stood up. And of course, since those days, they never asked you, used to know how to tell people to close their eyes. The other boys really laughed. And my legs started having fellowship. Now, and the Muslim still insisted, I must talk. It was very difficult to talk. But I still thought, with my legs having fellowship, I say, I want to receive Jesus as my personal savior until he comes for me. And I sat as quickly as I stood. But you know, the Lord is good. He has been with me since 1964. But it took that museum to come, because it's not a church. The primary school was not near the church. So the church used to send people to come to teach in the primary school. It took that museum to come to my primary school for me to come to know the Lord. By the time I went to high school, I now found other young people. Because for a long time, the only person I would go for fellowship to Kenya, the only fellowship available in my village, to Teresa, I would go for the fellowship, and the second youngest person, the next youngest person would be double my age. Because I would be 14, the guy is 30, the young person of the Teresa fellowship. So it's only when I went to high school now, I met people of my age who are born again. And it's the KSF thing made the difference in my life. It was quite a struggle before I went to in this fellowship, where people are talking about the adultery, udhalia now in Kikuyu, and I kept wondering, what are they rapping now? because the world didn't quite have a concept for a young person. Now anyway, that's a story for another day. All I'm trying to get you to understand is money never brought you to the Lord. Somebody talked to you. If you are really born again, how come for a whole week you have not talked to anybody about Jesus Christ? So that's the first thing I'm arguing my, and I'm not going to spend time on it, but that's the first thing I argue. I give reasons, lies, professionals believe. That's what I call the chapter. Now it's also in my website, but now it's going to be in the book. Lies, professional belief. Believing that your money is being measured. You know what the picture you are creating is that the pastor is not supposed to tithe because himself he is doing mission work. So that your money. Now, God wants you to speak with your mouth, but he still wants your money. Are we together? So pastors must tithe. The Levites were expected to tithe, isn't it? So every pastor, although the money they got from a tithe, must also tithe. The same thing, every professional, even as they're giving the money, must still witness. The other thing that people like to say is, they don't have a gift in evangelism. Second lie. With me, I don't have a gift. You go to this passage and you'll still understand this message, the passage we read, Acts 1:8. It was not addressed to apostles. If you now check, you'll see, and I'll be demonstrating in a minute, it was actually given to 120 people in the upper room. It was not the 12. And they were told, wait in Jerusalem. Not 12, but 120. When the Spirit comes on you, how will you know he has come? You will be my witnesses. So that witnessing is not the same as pastoring. Witnessing is sharing Jesus. And it's not a gift. It's a requirement for everybody born again. However, let's admit, there are people with the gift of evangelism. When I go out to evangelize, I bring two people to the Lord. When somebody who has an anointing and a gift in evangelism, you bring 10. But you know what happens? When we both go, we will get 12, isn't it? If he had gone alone, you'd have brought only 10. Are you getting my point? And that's why the Lord did not give anybody the privilege that you can send your money to God. Everybody witnesses. Those with a gift and those without. The example I like giving pastors is this one. Do you know there are people with the gift of giving? It's in the scriptures. And I can give you examples in my own life where I know somebody with a gift of giving. They give. I remember I had a neighbor, a Christian lady. She will go to town and this is somebody stranded. The next thing, you find the woman in the house. So we ask her, how do you know this is not a crook? He says, but I couldn't have left her on the street. Now, then she brought all kinds of chaotic things in her own house. I knew this is a special gift. Rebecca and I don't have it. You need to understand there are people with a gift. Are we together? Now, let's then say, a pastor who recognizes gifts on Sunday should say, the bag is passing around. Those of you with the gift of giving, please give. Others, let the bag
pastor. Ever had a pastor who says that? Yet the same pastors are willing to tell their congregation that there is going to be mission next week for those with the gift of evangelism. Are you getting my point? That the pastors understand when people are not evangelizing, they understand. It's lack of a gift. And yet they don't seem to recognize it when it comes to money. For money they want everybody to give. Are you getting my point? The thing is, the whole church, you cannot call yourself a mission church if only a small fraction of your born-again believers are involved. By the way, when I talk about the church, remember I've already defined my church. There are people welcome to the church and they are welcome. They must be allowed to keep coming. We must allow them to keep coming. But they are not members of the church. They are friends of the church. And we must work for them. We must minister to them until one day they receive the Lord. So now I'm talking about the church. I'm talking about people born again. So even if you are in the deacon board, if you are not born again, you are not my candidate. Because what will you be going to tell others if you yourself haven't got it? So we are only talking about born again people and the members of the church. Then we are saying among those, 100% of them must be there. So that's a concept that is new. I'm hoping my book will try to demonstrate it because that's why I've written the book. Because I've seen the biggest problem of the Kenyan church, and I think it's wider than the Kenyan problem, is that you have people, given people, very involved in God's work. The rest of them feel like it's normal to come on Sunday and go away to fry pasta. You know pasta is a French Italian food? You know pasta? You know pasta, the Italian food? That's the one most church goers normally eat pasta for lunch. They fry pasta, you know? Are you getting the point?
Yes,
oh yeah, that pastor. What was he saying? Surely he's English. Now, what's wrong with him? Now, that's called frying pasta. And that's what people eat for lunch. Now, every Sunday they eat pasta for lunch. Now, and that's what people do. They come to church to accumulate enough food for their lunch. Now, look at them. And they're singing. Surely that choir. What's wrong with them? Now, that's called frying pasta. Now, it's important to understand the reason you fry pasta is because you're not part of it. If you are part of it, if you are in the choir, will you be criticizing the choir? No. So the reason the church must change to where the church is involved. So what I'm trying to say is, if you're the whole of today, that's what we are going to emphasize. That mission is not telling missionaries. Of course, you're talking about going out there. That is only a few who can go. Now, I'm talking about the whole church getting involved on a weekly basis, having a system of witnessing to people. In their workplace, there is something they are doing so that their clients don't just get services, they also get Christ. They sell their service, they give away Jesus. All at the same time. So that your workplace, which is what I'm arguing in my book, must be your mission field. That's how the church will be involved. And I want to tell you, if Lavington United was to try this idea of the whole church, do you know this church cannot fit your members? But you mean that if you assume, for example, 2/3 of your members are born again, if they all go for one person per week, some will not agree to come. But some will come, isn't it? You can't fit them. There's no way this church will be enough. The reason why your congregation fits in is because the work of witnessing has been left to a mission committee and the pastors. And obviously, like pastors are the most hopeless people in witnessing. Because the pastor is busy throughout the week talking to Christians. This one has quarreled with his wife. That one has quarreled with his son. But they are born again, isn't it? That's not God witnessing. So, I was talking to a pastor the other day, he says, you know the truth, the whole week I have not met a single non-Christian. He is so busy, but he doesn't deal with non-Christians. But for somebody like the chairman, he hardly meets Christians. It's the other way around. Everybody he meets is a non-Christian. Are we together? So that if he makes up his mind, he is going to witness. He doesn't have to carry any effort. It's just there. It just happens. Because he's with them. So if we leave people who have no capacity to reach out, to be the reaching out, can you see the church not growing? No. So it is, and I don't know what happened to the church, because I'm not talking about Loving United. That's the average position anywhere, and I go to many churches, like I told you, for the last 30 years. I mean, I'm Pentecostals one time, Anglican the next. I'm everywhere, on a continuous basis. The Lord just seems to open doors to everywhere. But the point is, as I go from church to church, I do not meet churches where this is the truth. The whole church is involved in reaching out. So that's what you are here for. The committee, the work of the mission committee in this church is not to reach out, it's to facilitate other people reaching out. So there is the success of the mission will not be how many missions they went, but what percentage of the born again believers in this church are involved in verbally communicating Christ to others. If only a small group, it means the committee is not succeeding in its prayers. So it means you must understand your concept as the whole church. But number two, which is in this mission concept, you must go to the whole world. Because you can be doing a lot of mission, but you are not doing Jerusalem, isn't it? So it's important for each church to start saying, how can I be involved in Samaria and othermost parts of the earth without necessarily giving up on Jerusalem? And it's something that we say the whole church, every believer must be involved in mission. But number two, they must be involved in going everywhere. That's why, for example, for me, I don't know how, what we can do. But we actually told our missionaries, one of the responsibilities we are giving them is to move from church to church, sharing the testimonies that of the experiences in northern Kenya, so the other churches can get involved. Well, it's terribly embarrassing after 150 years for some tribe in Kenya not to have heard of Christ. Don't you agree with me? Something must be done, not tomorrow, but today. We urgently must pick up. Each church in Nairobi must pick up one tribe. And in prayer, consider how to reach out that tribe to the Lord. So we are talking about we must go to the whole world. There is no corner that is going to be outside the boundaries. It means that even the places we have, they are clearly saying they are going to kill you. You must go. They'll kill the first one, they kill the second one, kill the third one, but the fifth one might survive, isn't it? Because obviously, that's what Christ did for us. He came and died for us. And it's important that we ask ourselves, what are we doing? And you know, in Kenya, it is not even as complicated as that. If this church could develop the young people to have the mission concept, do you know you don't have to even to raise money? As people finish university, they'll be looking for jobs in Mandera. Nobody wants to go to Mandera. So, for example, TSC, if you offer yourself to go to Mandera, be sure you have it. Because nobody wants to go. So if this means somebody wanting to go, they'll send you there, isn't it? You are a doctor. You just graduated from medical school. And you want to be posted in Wajir. Guess whether there will be competition? No. Oh, yeah. The trouble is, a lot of people want to go to Kenyatta Hospital, Kenyatta National Hospital. That's why they cannot get the posting. We are saying the idea of going the whole world does not mean the church necessarily paying. It means that among your professionals, they start looking for work in locations where they can become the witness of the Lord in those locations. And so we are able to reach many more people. If by that. So the emphasis here is we are going to the whole world. But the final one is we must go with the whole gospel. Because it's very easy to look for numbers and so compromise your message in order for people to get saved. Isn't that a temptation? Yeah. You can see the kind of people who are in church today. Like for example, most people, the former president was a regular in church. But most pastors cannot preach the sermon they meant for that day. With more in, the sermon just changes. Are you getting my point? Why? Because they don't want the whole gospel to be heard by everybody. They have to, and that happens very easily, where you compromise your message. Sometimes it's those of us who go preaching in places. Since I want to be invited again, Loving United, so I compromise my message so they can get another invitation. That's not God's messenger. God's messenger, if you are called a messenger, if you are carrying a letter from me to Reverend, you can't go on the way and change it. Aye, that's rude. You can't tell your pastor that. You are not allowed. You carry my message, isn't it? That's what a messenger is. If I suspected you are likely to change my message, would I use you as my messenger? No. So if Christ wants to make you a messenger, you must be willing to carry the same message he has given. And fortunately for you, it's in writing. The word of God is there. Have you heard people who like speaking in a very holy language? They tell you, you know, me, I don't preach something I have not experienced. If you see me preaching something, I only preach something that I have experienced. And they sound very holy. Those kind of people are people who are not God's messengers. Because God's messenger, God will give you a message you have no experience on. Will you tell him I will not give it? Am I communicating? You need to understand that every messenger of the gospel is like this. It is one beggar telling other beggars where to find bread. So even as I'm telling you about the gospel, even me, I'm struggling. Are we together? It's not that you have arrived. You are still good in process. You're not finished. So you don't become a witness of becoming perfect. If you are perfect, you'd have gone. You know, if you are in a factory, once you reach a perfect place, we put you in the showroom, isn't it? The reason you are not yet in the showroom is because they are still working on, and the showroom is in heaven. Do you know we are going to have a showroom in heaven where Christ will be showing us for people to see the people he rescued out from the earth? But then, as long as you are here, you are good in process, and yet you must become a witness. That means there will be messages you are giving, and you yourself are struggling with. Because you are not telling them, I am telling you to do. I'm saying we are told to do. In other words, God's message is a message to them and a message to me. Are we together? So that you must understand that God is not waiting for you to become perfect, for you to become a witness. It is, as the process is going on, you are expected to continue to witness. You know, the New Testament churches were the ones that were straight. Because Paul had been in a place for 6 months. Then he leaves the place. He is not writing letters for them. And from the letter, he expects them to continue growing the church. Did you get that idea in the letters of Paul? Yet he had only been there for 3 months. Maximum 2 years. But those people were called bishops and pastors, and he had only been there for a short period. How come we think that, oh, I only got saved last year? Those were only saved for 6 months. You have been saved for a year. And some of us like me have been saved for more than 40 years. So what is it we are waiting for? In order to become witnesses. So we are saying it has to be the whole gospel. Whether you have experienced it or you have not yet experienced it. You say what the word says. That's what the gospel is all about. It's not necessarily what you are able to experience. You say what the gospel says. And let the people know that you are not the best. You are showing them Christ as the one to follow. They are not to follow you, but follow Christ. You are just a signboard pointing people to Christ. And it's important that you understand that. So that's my understanding, that the church must be the whole church involved. If you are really a mission church, everybody must be involved in witnessing. Do you know, as you see the excitement of the people getting saved, you start imagining, now, if I was in the city of Frankfurt, I would also witness. You go there. But you did your practice in Jerusalem, isn't it? So this person who wants to be a missionary in Frankfurt, because he wants to be in Germany, and does not do anything in Jerusalem, are they likely to be well trained? No. So you need to understand. The same thing with your relatives. Some of you, over Christmas, you have big parties with your relatives. Never mention nothing about Christ. And you still want to be sent for a mission. Which is sure, that's a mission. When your father calls all the brothers, all sisters, all clans together, sure, what is that a big mission, isn't it? Now, if you can do nothing there, what else are you expecting to do elsewhere? And certainly, if you truly have people you love, are they not in that meeting? Your wife is there, your cousin is there, your father is there. Shouldn't you be looking for a way, telling them, I know you're having a family meeting, please allow me for 10 minutes to set a devotion so that our mind can be controlled by God as we talk. And most people do not refuse. Am I right? You know, this week I've been given a contract to help train groups along the northern corridor on how to react to petroleum accidents. And this week I was in Sultan Hamoud, and there was such a big jam. I live on Westlands on Yaki Way. Now there was such a big jam that it took me to, I got Nyayo Stadium 1.5 hours later. And I had hoped that since Sultan Hamoud is only 110 kilometers, I could be there within 1.5 hours. 1.5 hours, I was actually still in Nairobi. So I ended up arriving at 9 o'clock. When I arrived, I found, and remember, this is not a Christian meeting. They are just people, volunteers from that town, who would like to be trained on how to respond to accidents. St. John's Ambulance are the ones who had helped to organize the group to get the volunteers together. And I was surprised to arrive and find somebody preaching. It was a devotion before the trainer comes. So I sat to listen. I said, what? These are total non-Christians, but they are willing to allow one of them who is a Christian to share the gospel. Are you getting my point? It doesn't mean they became Christians, but they went with a message, isn't it? At the end, because of having seen, it took me more than 3 hours on the road. And by the time the thing ended at 4, I counted it would take me more than, I would have to drive in the dark. So I was leaving and going, one thing, but sir, we haven't prayed yet. I was very embarrassed. I had to sit down for them to pray for the end of the meeting. That's Kenya for you. Are we together? So how come your family meetings, there's no witness? It's only because you are not sure that what you have is better than what they have. You know, if I'm working for Shell, like I did for that year, and it's not a good place, am I likely to encourage anybody to join me? But if I'm being paid well, they have good HR policies. Anybody I see, I'll tell them, please apply, because I'm happy where I am. Do you understand why most of us don't witness? It's because we are not sure what we have is better than what they have. After all, you can see one of your brothers is doing so well in his career. He seems to be, he has better things than you. He has married a wife more beautiful than you are. Now, you look at him and say, surely, how do I sit here telling about the Lord? Who can see in my family that I'm not doing as well as him? And you believe that story? However well you do without the Lord, are you really doing well? No. Now, if you are convinced that what you have, it's what you want everybody to have. You know, Paul, he told a king. The king wondered, the way you are preaching, you expect me to become a Christian. King Agrippa, he said, I wish you are like me, except for this chains. You remember the story? Now, so what I'm trying to say is that if you are to become a mission-setting church, that's why you heard me emphasize about the membership. You must be so happy with Christ, you believe the best thing that happened to you was to know Christ. And when that is what you believe, every time you see somebody not a Christian, you feel, oh God, that you'd bring him to yourself. Because you know very well that what you are getting is, there's nobody who can give you what you are getting. So I want to challenge you today. Do you really believe that a Christian is living? Not in heaven, I'm talking about earth. Of course, heaven is good. You go to hell, we go to heaven. But I want to tell you, Christianity is not just useful after you die. It's useful when you're here. As Singer said, even if there was no heaven, I would still want to serve the Lord today. Ever heard of that song? In other words, he was saying, even if somebody was to die, there's no heaven. It is so good to be a Christian today. I would still want to be a Christian, even if there was no heaven. Those are the type of people who witness, isn't it? Where they not only value heaven, because if you value heaven, then you feel like backsliding for a while. When you are just about to die, you get saved. Because in your mind, you believe that you only got saved to go to heaven, and heaven is not coming. So you backslide, isn't it? Now, but if you enjoy the walk with the Lord today, can you see you will not be able to hold back telling people about the Lord when you are sure about it. So that we as a church must be able to show our members about what they are experiencing in the Lord. What they should be experiencing in the Lord. And teach them to enjoy it so seriously. They will not keep quiet in their family meeting, in their estate security meetings. Are there such things in your area? All those are opportunities for people to know about Christ. Of course, you have to be wise how you do it, otherwise they could throw you out. But the Bible really tells us about being white as serpent, as harmless as doves. That's what you're saying. But what I'm after is not even the action. I'm after the attitude. Understanding that what you have is so valuable. Nobody else has it. I realize my time is up. I may not, and I've gone beyond tea time. But I hope in setting the background, because that's what I wanted to do in this first session, I hope I have put ideas in your mind, and I hope the Holy Spirit will take them, that all of us must be involved in witnessing. And the church must look for ways and means of getting the majority of the members, or those of us who are born again, get involved in witnessing. And I hope I've gotten to where I've set the stage that Lavington must start witnessing below Jerusalem. Are we together?
Yes.
Assuming they are witnessing Jerusalem. And I've also set the stage where you don't compromise the gospel. You give the whole gospel. Wakikata, that's not your area. That is God's area. You only give the message. And that's really your responsibility. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, how we pray that as we go into the rest of the day, what we have said so far will set the stage and help us, every one of us before leaving here, to be committed to be witnesses. And then to go beyond that, to be committed to assist others to also become witnesses. And for the church, to be committed to help the church to become a missionary sending church. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the message. I believe all of us are